Co-op's a church service, and we always pick out different preachers to come and minister, and we've got one that's going to come and preach for us and say if God will bless it. But I want everybody to remember the day, remember the time. Don't get too wrapped up in chainsaws and brushing and forget what you're doing and not making it. But it does start, if you're ordained and want to come to the pre-meeting, you're more than welcome to come to the pre-meeting. But it starts at 6 o'clock. Don't forget, bring a dish. When I say a dish, provides the chicken.
A big dish.
Yeah, the church provides the chicken, but we need other dishes to go along with it. So bring a dish, and I expect and hope to see most of the congregation at the fellowship. I don't care if you don't ever go to a fellowship nowhere else. If it's at our home church, then we need to support it. So that's just the way I feel as a pastor. That's the way I think any church should feel. And I know the rest of the brothers feel the same way about their own churches. But if you have planned, that's fine. I'm not dogging anybody, but I'm just saying if you should be here and help support it. But that being said, look here, come in. You better off playing. At least you put pressure on her. Look here, boy. Yeah. Now, I don't need no wheel here.
Oh, just to get up that ramp.
Yep.
I think they took it out for Doug.
So glad to have you, Mom. Inspiration to us all, especially to the whole church. Not only because of her accident, because of her servitude to the Lord. And today, you know, as I was driving, we were driving in town, and I was thinking, you know, about opening this service up and how on Easter, we'll say Happy Easter or whatever, but we'll say Happy Memorial Day. And it kind of sounds kind of strange why we would say that. But we're happy today because of the memories that are left behind in our hearts and in our minds of all those that have gone, all those saints of God, friends, and loved ones. We're happy today because those who have been born again are in a better place than what we are. Mm-hmm. And plus, we're happy, like I said, because of the memories that we can share in our hearts and our minds, and we love them and we miss them dearly. But so this morning, you know what? Let's get right into the service. Let's be obedient to the Spirit today. Let's have a good time in the house of the Lord. I don't know why you came, but I come to get a blessing. And if you're obedient to that, if you're obedient to the Spirit today, you know what? I can give just that. But you know what it takes all of us being obedient to the Spirit? Because the Bible says the Spirit is subject to the prophet. Who's the prophet? You are. The Spirit lives in you.
Yeah.
And you're the prophet, and that Spirit is subject to you. You can sit on it and quench it today. You know that? You can sit on it. Lord, tell you to do something, and you can sit there and not do a thing. You cheat somebody else out of a blessing. You can do that. But I urge you not to do that. I urge you to be obedient to the Spirit today. And let's just get right into the service. We got any birthdays or anniversaries this morning? Any birthdays or anniversaries? Where you at, Bobby?
I'm here.
No. Oh, you want? Oh, no, you're just still. Come on, Wally. Come on, Wally. J.R. Blaney.
I
got
a scene.
Oh my goodness. Poor
he's got to sing. Now, save your legs. Your voice is going to hurt from it. Got any birthdays or anniversaries? We have none. Well, let's all stand our feet and reverence the Lord then. How's that?
There you go.
We got a lot of action today. A lot of business in other churches. A lot of happening. Reunions and stuff going on. But you know what? We've got enough. The Bible says where there are two or three, he said, I'd be in the presence. So you know what? He's here today. Let's just enjoy the Lord. We ain't got no birthdays or anniversary. We want to reverence the Lord for who he is. And we're going to ask Brother J.R. if he'd ask the Lord to bless his service and bless the offering we're about ready to take up. bless this service today, dear Lord. If there's anyone here that does not know you as their personal Savior, dear Lord, today would be a great day for them to open their heart and receive you. Dear Lord, bless this offering that we're about to take up, and it'll be upfilled in your kingdom. When you're done with us, dear Lord, take us to heaven. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As they're taking up the offering, everybody sing. Come on up and help us sing.
I started to sing it.
Thank you.
10. Let's all stand to our feet while we sing this song. Shake hands, have a little bit of fellowship. We'll see. I'll tell you, how many glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Amen. I'll tell you what, it is good to be here. And you know what? To be with brothers and sisters in Christ, but you know what? To be in the presence of the Lord today. This is His house. This house is holy. And you know what? God is holy. So we need to reverence Him in everything that we do today. I tell you what, I love the Lord. Truly love the Lord. Truly thank God for another day of life. But most of all today, I thank Him for His Son.
Yeah.
And you know what? All the stupidity that I do, we just kind of talk in Sunday school, the ignorance of man and how that we are so ignorant to the Word of the Lord, to how God operates, to we will never understand, as long as we live down here, we'll never understand the true love of God. We can't understand that. If we could understand that, we would be able to give our son or our daughter for a lost and dying generation. And Brother Frank, on my end, that just isn't possible. I love my children so dear that I wouldn't give them. I love you all, but I wouldn't give them one for anybody in this house. I give my own life for my children, but I wouldn't give their life for anybody.
Come on.
So we'll never understand, Brother Jimmy. If we could understand that kind of love, we would understand how God operates.
Man.
But we can't understand that. We'll never comprehend that. So, you know, every day that we live, we must understand who God is in our lives and what He has done for us. And although we thank Him for the many things that we have, you know, in my prayer, it seems like every day when I pray, I thank Him first for His Son. Because it is His Son is why it's possible that I stand here. It's because of His Son that I have the authority to bow my head no matter where I'm at and call upon Him. And you know what? He's not far off. You know, the servants of Baal got on the mount there with the prophet Elijah, and they began to call out to their God. They began to cry out. And Elijah said, well, maybe He's not hearing you. Maybe you need to cry a little louder. And you know, Elijah was a little, he was mocking them just a little bit. He was making fun of them.
Come on.
Because they would begin to call out and cry out to Baal, and there was no answer.
Yeah, all right, son.
He said, call a little louder. Maybe he's gone on a journey.
Maybe he'll answer.
They begin to cry out that much louder. And the Bible said they begin to take their knives and begin to cut themselves and open up wounds and let the blood flow out, but still Baal never answered.
Come on.
Still Baal never answered. It would become Elijah's turn.
Come on.
Elijah took that altar that they had torn down.
Yeah.
He took the Bible, if you read it in the book, that he took the stones and he placed them back up on the altar.
Come on.
He took the wood. It doesn't say that he just threw the wood in place, but he said he laid it in place.
Come on.
Placed it to where it needed to be. And then when he got there, you know what? He poured water over top of that altar.
That's right.
And the water is signification of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God.
Come on.
And he poured that water over top of that altar so much that they dug a trench around it. And then not only did it saturate the altar, but it filled up the trench there around. And when he began to cry upon the Lord, his God, the God that he knew would answer, the fire from heaven came down.
Amen.
And brother, let me tell you what, not only did it consume the sacrifice, but the Bible said that it lapped the water up out of the ditch.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you something today. You know what? We're in the presence of the Lord today. When we call upon the name of God through Christ Jesus, his Son, you know what? He is obligated to show up.
Yes.
If you'll do that with your whole heart today, if you'll say, Lord, you know what? Bless me through your Son, Lord. Hear me. Through your Son Christ Jesus, I have need in mind. You know what? God will answer.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost will show up. And I tell you what, things are starting to happen.
That's right. Yeah.
Nothing happened on that mountain until Elijah called out.
Amen.
Nothing but a bunch of empty wailing. Nothing but a bunch of empty cries. Yeah. As they called out for their God that didn't even exist. But you know what? We got a God today that hears us.
Amen.
So you know what? If you're here today and you'll be obedient to that Spirit, you'll call upon the name of the Lord through Christ Jesus. Yes, sir. Things start happening.
That's right, son.
Things start happening. We wonder why things happen in our lives. But you know what? If we would have just a little bit, I preached on that for months here, a little bit better communication with the Lord, with God, we start seeing different things happen in our lives.
Come on.
It requires a daily communication with God. You know what? Me and my wife, our marriage, I base my plan of salvation is based on marriage. And I work on my marriage every day. Almost 30 years I've worked on my marriage. And you know what? Every day, Sister Maddie, I work on my relationship with the Lord.
Come on.
The same way I work on my relationship with my wife. I know her, but I don't know the depths of her. I know God, but I don't understand the depths of God. And in everything in the Bible, if you read about your plan of salvation and how that Jesus come along, is based on the marriage. I made a marriage proposal down on my knees and an old-fashioned prayer. I stood in an altar with that lady over and I promised to love and to cherish her. You know what? When I got down on my knees, I promised to accept him.
Come
in my life and live according to His word, Brother David. And you know what? I work on that every day. Do I mess up in my marriage? Yes. Do I mess up in my salvation? Yes, I've messed up many times. Just because I'm a pastor, I'm not perfect. But you know what? I work on that every day. How do I work on that? I get down and I call out to God my Father through Christ His Son that gave me that authority to do that. And you know what? You can see things happen in your life. You can see your life totally turn around and change for the better.
Amen.
So you know what? Today I know there's a lot here and a lot gone, but let's just enjoy the Lord today. Amen. Enjoy His Spirit, because you know what? His Spirit is sweet today.
Amen.
It's sweet to those that have been born again. Brother, there ain't nothing better than to feel the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Now, if you're here today and you don't know the Lord, you might feel something else. You're going to feel a convicting spirit, a convicting power come across you, and it's going to remind you of what you are and who you are. And what you need to be. And you know what? If you listen to that, you know what? It can make a change in your life today.
Amen.
Make a change in your life. The first thing that's got to happen is, guess what? You've got to make a proposal to the Lord.
Right.
Yeah. You've got to come down to an old-fashioned altar prayer and say, Lord, I know who I am.
Right.
I know who I am, but I know what you've done for me, and I need you in my life.
Yep.
Because my life is just going nowhere. You know, that's the way I was. I wasn't a bad man. I've done a lot of bad things, and I'm not proud of what I've done. Along the way, Brother Paul, we've done a lot. But you know what? It wasn't too much that I could not call out to my Lord.
Right.
He hears me that day.
Amen.
And of all the stupid things I've done, He still said, you know what? I love you enough. Love you enough. So, you know what? We're going to get ready to go to Lord prayer. We all have a prayer request by the way. If you've got something special throughout this church service week, I urge you to speak it. But you know what? I just tell you what, I just feel like today maybe there's somebody here. I don't know. I can't, I'm not going to lie to you that I forgot my glasses, my contact. I can't see past the first pew, hardly. Not a face. You're all a blur. But you know what? God sees you. God knows exactly where you are, exactly where you're sitting, exactly where you're standing. He knows you inside and out. So I'm going to ask everybody back here. We're going to get ready to go to the Lord in prayer. Yes, they've been on our hearts and our minds.
Yeah, and also, they raised Jenny's husband killed himself. So,
Lord have mercy.
You know, there's a lot, you know, in this whole world, and if we live long enough, we'll see more. And you wonder, you know, and I thought about the Combs family this weekend a whole lot, and the tragedy that has hit their life. And a lot of people say, why would God do something like that? God did not do that. Let me get this straight. God's not punishing them for anything. He surely is not. God doesn't work like that. When you accept God into your life and you start that communication, what I'm talking about, then God starts intervening in your day-to-day things. Do you know that?
Yes.
If you're lost, God's not out there just punishing you. You're bringing these things on yourself.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You bring these things on yourself. Accidents are going to happen. Death is going to come. It's inevitable. But know this, that my God is not, you know what, there's a punishment coming for the lost.
Amen.
It's not by Him taking their family. It's not by Him casting sickness on, because God doesn't work like that.
Come on, son.
God doesn't move like that, children. I'm telling you, there's a punishment coming for those that are lost.
Come on.
At the end. All these things, you know what, all the stupid things I've done when I was young, guess who done them? All done. I brought everything for myself because of this. I told my wife the other day, the decisions that we make in our day-to-day life, they alter some outcomes.
Yep.
So you know what? There's decisions that's got to be made here today. There's decisions that the saved have to make. Do I want to keep serving the Lord? Do I want to give Him all of me today? There's decisions today that the lost, if you're here, have got to make. Do I want to accept Christ Jesus? God's not punishing him. There's a punishment day coming, and there's a day of rewards coming.
All right. Come on.
God's not down here casting death and sickness in our family. God doesn't work like that.
Come on.
Day-to-day life, day-to-day decisions make those. And life comes, life goes, death comes. But God's not up there doing that. I wondered a lot about that family. And you know what? We need to pray for them. They've lost so much.
Yeah, come on.
But you know what? God is still able.
Amen.
Betty made a comment. I wonder if she had time.
You know what? That's the thought I think of a lot of people when they die in this world. If I know that they're lost or saved, I wonder if they had time to pray. You know, I'll say this and we'll take care of it.
I've often thought about deathbed salvation. Does it exist? Yes. Yes. The Spirit of the Lord has to be there. I believe that too. But if we look at an example on the mountain when Christ was crucified, the man on the right said, "Lord, remember me when you go into your Father's house."
It is. Come on.
And Jesus plainly told us, "Fear not this earth, the death peace, and for today that's got me with me in paradise." Paradise wasn't emptied out yet, it still existed, because Christ hadn't was resurrected. But I don't want to wait. I don't want to take a chance of being on my deathbed tomorrow, and the Spirit of the Lord will not be with me.
Come on.
I don't want to take that chance. So you know what? I urge you not to take that chance. I urge you to make some decisions today as Christians. I ask you to make some decisions today that maybe those that have been saved and strayed along the way, I ask you to make some decisions today. I ask you if you're here today and you're lost, because I don't know your heart and your soul. I just see you.
Come on.
I don't know what's on the inside, Sissy. But I urge you to make some decisions today that will alter your life. It can change your life, you know. You say, "My life is such a wreck, there ain't no hope." There's hope today in Christ Jesus. And the one writer said it was a lively hope.
That's right.
Amen.
I'm not serving somebody that's dead. I'm not calling out to an empty God, but I'm calling out to a God that hears.
Yeah.
I'm calling out to a God that's still saved, and he still offers the outcomes of my life, day to day. Why? Because I call on him, because I know that without him, I can't do nothing.
Come on.
Well, why'd you cut your leg? It's my ignorance.
Come on.
But God will look down upon me. I didn't cut through the bone.
Come on.
So you know what? He can alter things in the life of a man or a woman who has communication and relationship with the Lord. That's what it takes today to get saved. It takes having a relationship with God. It takes knowing who you are and knowing who God is. And you know what? If you'll pray, but let me tell you what, Gary, if you'll call on him, hey, in the hour of need, he will not forsake you.
Yes.
He will not. So let's all bow our heads this morning. We're going to get ready to go to the Lord in prayer. Don't do this to embarrass anybody. I do this to encourage you, because there's decisions that have to be made. You know, every day of my life, I've got to make a decision. When I wake up, I want to live for Jesus.
Amen.
I make the decision every day, you know what? I said, "Lord, look down upon me this day, bless me and keep me in this day." And I make that decision every day. Why? Because I know what's ahead of me is better than what was behind me.
Amen.
And I'm looking forward to a day coming when I don't have to worry about no more death, no more sickness, no more cut legs, broke hips, broke backs, no more days of wondering where the next meal is going to come from.
Amen. Come on.
Because you know what? He is Jehovah Jireh. He is God my provider.
Amen.
He is Jehovah Rope. He is God my healer. He is everything today that you need.
That's right.
But you got to call him. So I'm going to ask, as all heads are bowed, all Christians, please be praying. Is there somebody here today that don't know the Lord? Have not accepted him as their personal Savior? Friend, I want to urge you. Well, don't do this to embarrass you, but would you just raise your hand by this? You say, "Church, just pray for me." Just raise it up and take it right back down. That's all you got to do. We do this every Sunday morning and every Wednesday night. I think we have about 15 here Wednesday night. And everybody that was in the house was saved. I know I either helped baptize them or I've worked with them a long time. But you know what? There's things that happen in day-to-day sometimes that tries to lure us away from the Lord.
That's right. Come on.
That flesh is still there. It's still real. And it still desires the things of the flesh. So you know what? I don't know what happened between now and last night. I have no idea. But God knows. So I'm going to ask today, if you're here, you don't know the Lord, you just raise your hand. Take it right back down. Just by that, you're saying, "Church, pray for me." I'm not going to come back and shake your hand. I'm not going to corner you after church. I'm not going to call you on the phone. Nobody here is going to do that.
Come on.
But I'm going to encourage you right now. If you don't know Christ Jesus as your personal Savior, maybe you've been saved and you've just drifted too far from the shore. You know, there's still an anchor that holds. There's still an anchor that holds today.
Come on.
So how about it? Would you raise your hand? By this, you say, "Church, pray for me. I've drifted a little too far from the shore. It just seems like it's hard to get back to where I am." It's not, friend. You make it hard on yourself. So how about it? Let me tarry just for a minute. The Lord wants to save you, and he's able to do that if you'll just let it. You've got to get you out of the way. Stop worrying about what's coming tomorrow.
Stop worrying about, well, what if I give my heart to the Lord? Is that going to change this or that? Don't worry about stuff like that. Give your heart to the Lord and ask the Lord to help you day by day by day by day. It's a daily thing. Truly is.
Amen.
Yes, sir. You know what? I'm saved forever as long as Paul Heiner wants to be.
Amen.
You believe that?
Yeah.
That's right. I'm saved forever as long as Paul Heiner wants to be. God doesn't make me serve him. I serve him because I love him. I came to him because I feared him.
Amen.
Because I knew what that great day of punishment was all about. Friend, I urge you today, we carry just for a moment. Would there be one? Just raise your hand. By this, you say, here's the church, just pray for me. How about it? Don't mean to embarrass you, friend. Surely don't. But do you know where you stand with the Lord right now? A lot of silence in. Do you know where you stand with the Lord right now? I do. How about you? If you don't know where you stand with the Lord right now, I urge you just to raise that hand. And you know what? We'll pray for that hand. We'll pray for that one. But it takes being honest with yourself.
Amen.
It takes being honest with yourself, knowing where you are with the Lord. And knowing what steps you need to take to get back there. If not, I'm going to ask everybody just to gather right up around this altar. We're going to go with the Lord in prayer. What do you got?
There's a few prayer requests on Facebook that I don't want to go into all of them, but God knows who they
God
are.
God knows who they are.
So I'm going to pray for them.
Everybody will come on up, get the last round. Anybody need prayer call?
She was kind of in doubt, but I never had no doubt at all. As I said once before, when I prayed for her, I went to the foot of Christ. As it took her to Lexington Friday, they did the heart cast and come back and told her there was no blockage.
Well, so, amen. Give God a hand clap.
They told her to nurse that wrist for 3 to 4 days to make sure that it clogged off. Took some blood thinners and stuff beforehand, that it was dangerous if it busted back open. So pray for her that she'll continue to nurse that wrist.
Yeah, let's remember that.
Yes, you
are. Oh, I am too. Okay, well, everybody get another round. Anybody else want a prayer call? Anybody else want this prayer?
Remember Faye, they think she's got a pinched nerve in her leg and she's still having problems with that eye, that infection.
Ross, Allison, and Orton's all remember the Smithers family, the night they found a friend of mine dead last night. But you remember that family?
Our most kind, gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you once again, Father, as humble as we know how, Father. Father, asking you, Father, that you look down for his brothers and sisters, Father, whatever it may be, a need in their life. Father, we know that you're able, Father, to take care of that. Father, we come to you, Father, not just with a little thing. Father, we come to you with it all. And Father, we know, Father, we lay it down at your son's feet. Father, you'll take care of it. Father, your son's good. My path is good. It's not for me. For them around me may hear and see. Often they pray this morning. Will they be one here this morning that don't know you, Father? But we ask you, Father, that they will see how the power of your glory come down in this place today. Upon each and every one that's in the house today. Father, we come, Father, a servant of that Holy Spirit. Father, we breathe upon the disciples. Told them to receive the Holy Spirit. Father, we ask you this morning that you be that Holy Spirit upon your people this morning. You touch those that's in our hospital and you've been nursing home, Father. We ask you, Father, the little one has been shoved back.
Father, got nobody but you. The lean on Father when they need a comforter. We know you're right there. Father, we'd only believe and serve you, Father. Father, we need help. For this multitude of words, Father, will come. I'm trying to please the Spirit. Father, we ask all the men to follow and lead us and guide us, Father. Father, always be in obedience. Father, to you, Father. Father, we know that obedience is better than sacrifice. Father, we ask you to touch your brother, Father. Father, you will heal him through your talking of my way. Father, we heal him all. Father, we call, Father, hoping and praying, Father, receive a blessing, Father. And Father, we never fail to give you that praise and that honor that in Jesus' precious name, Father, you got up out of that tomb that day. Father, we can live again. Father, we lay down the walk of this life. Father, go on, we make the spirit. Father, bless the brother. Father, put forth the fresh bread of life, Father. Father, it will feed, Father, the lost sheep, Father. Father, it will feed the church, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Yes, there will be.
There'll be so much to do.
this mat for them, would you?
Thank you.
does. Me too, yes. I tell you what, when that Holy Ghost gets a hold of you, you'll move. Mm-hmm. Won't you, sissy?
I was raised in a holler. Didn't go no room to school. Didn't know what it was to go to church or anywhere else. And I was as backward as they come.
Come on. Yeah.
When that Holy Spirit comes to
me,
I'm as bold as a lion.
Yeah. baby mushroom prayer for.
Say, I love the Lord, and I'm glad to be here. This is my Lord. Thank Him for everything that He's done for me in my life.
Amen.
And thank you most of all for sending His Son, Jesus Christ, because I know without Him, there's one way that I can live. When I leave this life, and I understand that I'm leaving here, I understand that there's something going to go on, Brother J.R., after this life's over with.
Man,
I've seen that too many times. I've seen it happen too many times. I've seen men that used to walk and healthy and you know, big men and strong men. I've seen them go down and I've seen them leave this world.
Come on.
Drop my hat.
Yeah.
And I know I'm leaving here. The Bible says it's most appointed unto a man to die, Brother Bob.
Yeah, come on.
After that, the judgment. And you know, so oftentimes, and I know there's probably a person in this building. They never ask the same question that I've asked myself a lot of times.
Come on.
You're probably lying if you say you don't.
Come on, man.
We're really a God. How many times? If you're not asking yourself, if you're going to say you're lying this morning,
I've been going through my mind.
And I've thought this so many times in my mind, and I've thought this because I've been like David wrote in the Bible in the book of Psalms, in the 8th chapter, I believe it's in the 3rd verse.
Yeah, come on.
He said, whenever I think of the heavens,
yes,
and I think of the stars and the moon and all the work of thy
hands, come on,
when I think of all these things, what is man?
What is man?
That you're mindful of him. I think, is there a God? And then I look out and I see, and I know the book of Romans says this, and whenever I look out my window and I see the creation and I see all the things that God has created,
come on,
and I see all the things that He has made and the work of His fingers, and I see the moon and the stars, and I know it just didn't go boom and happen.
I'm all
I know there's a Bible, there's no question.
Amen.
Then I ask myself this question, who am I that God's mindful of me? David asked the question, who am I,
God?
That you love me.
Come on.
Who am I that you've done all these great things for me? And I've asked myself the same question.
Come on.
And the answer is simply love.
Amen.
Brother Paul was talking about this earlier, and as we get ready to get into the book of Romans, in the book of Ephesians, in the 3rd chapter, in the 19th verse, tells me why God done what He done.
Yeah, come on.
Tells me why. Because I can't understand. He loves me. The only thing that you can come up with, the only reasonable explanation.
Look, come on.
Love, He says that it surpasses all knowledge. That me or you or anybody else, the philosophers, the theologians, the Bible scholars can never understand why God done the things that He
does.
And I ask myself this question. So I ask you this morning that if you're sitting here and you're in
between,
you're in between this decision in your life, you don't know the Lord, and you got something tugging and pulling, that's God.
Come on,
amen.
That's God. That's not a conscience. That's the Holy Spirit dealing with your life.
Come on.
And I ask you this question, what if it is real? Brother J.R., the good things that I do in my life, trying to keep the righteousness of God by helping my friends and my neighbors, by loving people, by doing what's right.
Amen.
You know what? If there's no God, whenever I leave this world, I've not lost a thing. I know that I've been able to sleep at night and have a good day all the way down and not have to worry. Even if there ain't no God, you know what? The things that I've done, I'm going to be able to rest easy. But I do know this, that if there is a God, and the Bible said there's hope, man, I know it's come out here and on the inside of my heart. I don't have to ask nobody. Whenever His Spirit comes down, like your sister was saying earlier, and Christ Jesus.
Look,
and now we're a workmanship. I want you to understand that. this morning. Hey, you know what? If Brother Paul, Brother Paul's been a carpenter all his life. If he'd have built this pretty podium right here, and you know what? He'd have put time in it, and he'd have sanded it, and he'd have smoothed it, and he had his heart in it, and he'd done such a good job on it. He don't want to see it go to ruin.
Come on, come on.
Paul, how long have you been a carpenter? 30 years.
Yeah, come on.
How many things have you built and you stepped back and you looked and you said, boy, that's a creation. That's a workmanship.
That's right. Come
on. You know what you look at and you're proud of it. God sat back and he created man. The Bible said that he breathed the breath of life in the man.
Oh, yeah.
God stood back and you know what? I can only imagine.
Just like somebody to talk to.
And that book of Ephesians said that it surpasses all our knowledge. All our understanding. I can't even understand it. That's why from the beginning of time that God created us, he stood back and he looked and he said, I love man. Yep. And with a blood far greater than man can even understand, yep. I love him. And you know what? From that very time, hey, God's been trying to preserve mankind.
Come on.
Yes, he has. God has been, you know what? Through every covenant that God made with man. Through everything that God done, it was beneficial to man. But I want to read in the eighth chapter, in the third verse, just for a moment before we skip on over in the book of Romans.
Come on.
It said, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh.
Come on, son.
So see, through the Mosaic law and the Abrahamic law and the Levitical law, and through all these laws, there were 600 some Levitical laws.
Come on.
Hard for man, listen, every time that man messed up, every time that man seemed to do wrong, he had to go back. He didn't. You know what? And I kind of got on it this morning because I've been reading on this, and it's kind of a coincidence how it happened, Brother Paul.
Ain't no coincidence, not the Lord.
66 books in the Bible. You know what? We begin to talk about one thing. That ain't a coincidence.
No, that's the Lord, son.
You know what? I want you to understand that this morning. Hey, that these people back in this day, they had 600 some laws that they had to go by.
Come on.
Brother Chester, if I messed up, I would have to go back to the law. I wouldn't even know it for myself. I would have to look and say, what did I do wrong? Did I mess up?
Come on.
These people would have to go back. And then once they found that they messed up, they'd be sacrificed. They'd be all these things that they had to put forward.
That's right.
To be able to cleanse themselves from God. And you know what? It didn't even take care of it, Brother Allison. It just pushed it back for so long. That means it took care of it for just a short time. So he said, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh. There were so many of them that you couldn't even realize what you was doing wrong.
Come on.
He said, God sent in his own son. Here's the love that we was talking about a minute ago that me or you don't understand. I've got two little boys sitting over here, Brother Paul, and you know what? I love you, but I wouldn't give them for you. This is the love that I can't understand. This is the love that you can't understand, and I don't believe there's a living, breathing soul that lives upon this earth that can understand the great love that God has for us. But see, God done this. He said, because I want to make provision for my people, because I know that they can't live it because of this, because of all these laws that they're going to have to try to live, Brother Allison. I'm going to send my son because I love him.
Come on.
Simply because of love. I'm going to send my son the best that I have. I'm going to sacrifice my son to save my creation. I'm going to sacrifice the best that I have to save them. I want you to understand this. God sent in his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh. He sent his son into the same flesh, into sin, and to be sacrificed, and to be a holy and acceptable sacrifice.
Yeah,
and to be the ultimate sacrifice. And that wasn't just provisional. That didn't just take care of things for just a short while, and for just a little while, or push it back for a year. Should not perish, but have everlasting life. He didn't say shall not, but he said should not. same man. That fullness that I know is real. The confirmation in the Spirit. The Spirit that I can feel from my brothers and my sisters. And the Spirit that I can feel from God. Sister Jean, whenever you walk in, or you begin to sing one of them songs, and the Holy Spirit comes down, understand something this morning, that if you're here and you think that you can make it on your own, and you think that you can do things on your own, man's been doing this since the beginning of time. For what this says in 8 and 3, it says, for what man could not do, which man could not save himself, and that Jesus Christ and his Son, the best that he had, and to be the ultimate and supreme sacrifice, and they took care of our sins, and took care of the things, Brother Allison, and it separated me and God, and you and God forever.
Come on, son.
So this is what the Bible said. It said that he sent what all could not do. What me or you and man could not do out of the covenants that God made with each and every one. But what we could not do, God sent the best that he had to do for me and you.
Come on.
And it wasn't just a provisional sacrifice. This was a sacrifice and a last. Listen, this is what Christ said. He said, I am the same today, yesterday, forevermore. The same promise of the book of Deuteronomy, he said, the same promise that he's made even to 1,000 generations. And then he made to Abraham and Moses and Isaac and Jacob. All the same, even until 1,000 generations. Even until a man or a woman that walks up and they kneel down in an altar and they sign their name with the blood of Jesus Christ on that covenant with God. So I want you to understand this morning. Hey, that God come. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ. For what man could not do, Christ done, Brother Ray. For what man couldn't make it on his own, Christ made a way. So I want you to understand that real close this morning. I want you to understand there is a God. This God is real. This God is omniscient, omnipresent. He's everywhere and he's all knowing.
Amen.
He knows everything. So there is a God. He's real and he loves us with a love that you can't understand. And for what we've been trying to do for years and years and years, man could not do. Jesus Christ done for us. So it says, therefore, brother, in the 12th chapter, in the 12th verse of the 8th chapter, he says, therefore, brother, we are debtors. Therefore, brother, listen, we have an obligation. More else what this is saying. More or less, we have an obligation, and we owe our God everything. We owe our God from the time that we wake up in the morning until the time that we go to bed. We owe God 7 days a week, 24 hours a day of service. In the 12th chapter of the book of Romans, he says this. He says, brother, and I beseech you that you present yourselves holy and a living sacrifice unto the Lord. Hey, this is your reasonable service. Hey, Brother Jimmy, I want you to understand something today. Hey, that I owe my whole life to my God, because I understand. Hey, I know that I could not enter into the kingdom of heaven if my God did not send his Son, Jesus Christ. And I know that he led him, that he did everything that he had. He gave his life and he gave it all up for me.
Amen.
I know that Christ gave everything.
Amen.
He gave it all up. You know why? Because he wanted to do the will of the Father. And we owe God everything. Therefore, I am in debt to God.
Yeah, come on.
The people want to say this, and listen, I understand that salvation is free. The gift of God is free. He said it's a gift of God. But it cost him everything. It cost him Jesus Christ's life. It cost him being spit on. It cost him being humiliated. And the Bible said in John 1:11, he said he went unto his own and his own received him not. Mark 14:65 said, and that they spit on him, and they reviled against him. And the Bible said that even the servants hit him with the palms of their hands. Hey, could you imagine taking the punishment and the to Jesus Christ.
Oh, yeah.
I am into debt unto God. I owe him everything.
That's right. Come on.
Until you realize that in your life. He says this, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, ye shall die. I want you to understand something this morning. We owe God everything. And you know what? We walk around in this life and we make excuses up. And the Bible speaks to these people who self-justify. And it compares us to the Pharisees and the Sadducees that try to make up our own laws and to try to make up our own way of living and try to do things to satisfy this flesh. And you know, try to make up things for the enemy that we're right and wrong. I try to say it's okay just so I can justify myself and make myself feel better so I can try to sleep better at night. Hey, but you know what? I want you to understand this. The Bible also calls these people hypocrites. Hey, these people are people, Brother Paul. Hey, they're not going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Hey, these people are going to be like the ones that the book of Matthew says they're going to stand before me and say, Lord, hey, we cast out the image in your name.
Yeah,
and we've done great works in your name. And we've done all these things in your name, Brother James.
Oh.
And then he's going to look at him and he's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. We're debtors. We're debtors unto the Lord. We can't live after this flesh. We live after this flesh, we're going to die. It's simple. So what my brother Comey, when he preaches, he said, it's simple. It's the simplicity of the gospel, hey, that messes people's minds up. It's a decision that you've got to make in your life. I'm going to either choose to serve God or I'm going to walk after the flesh. But he said this, if you walk after the flesh, then you shall die. There ain't no you might die. There ain't no you may die. There ain't no if or ands in there. You will die. And what that means, Brother Jimmy, you're going to leave this world. Hey, this old flesh is going to go back to the dust of the earth. And whenever it goes back to the dust of the earth, it's going to go back. And these bones are going to melt away. Hey, this old flesh is going to melt away. Hey, but there's something that God breathed in the man's heart from the beginning of time. Hey, it's going to go back and it's going to stand. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says every man will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and they'll give an account for the things that they've done.
That's right. Come on,
whether it be good or bad, we're all going to stand.
What?
But if we live for this world, if we live after the flesh, if we
we're going to perish. Come on.
The things I want. Listen, I am going to stand before you and say that this flesh don't crave to do bad things every day, all day long. I ain't going to stand before you today and say that my mind don't think of some rotten things. I ain't going to stand before you and say that I don't mess up because I am flesh.
Right,
the Apostle Paul says this, that we are chief sinners. He said, I'm a chief sinner among you. And I am nothing more than a sinner that is been saved by grace. I want you to understand something this morning. Like I told him in Sunday school, and then whenever we forget to put on the rest of the armor of God, and we walk around as Christians, and we let rest pray the righteousness on, and we puff our chest out, Brother Bobby, and we think that we don't need nothing else, and we think we're something more than we are, and the Bible tells me I'm nothing at all, and there's one day I'm going to stand
before
a just God, and it's going to give me a reward that I deserve.
Come on.
And that's the biggest thing. We've got to understand that all these decisions that Brother Paul was talking about earlier, all these decisions that we make in this life, we're going to stand before a God that's going to make a decision based on all these decisions that we make. All these decisions that we make every day. With the Holy Spirit, and I was talking about all these laws, you know, and I said this morning in Sunday school, Brother Paul, we got something now that they didn't have then.
Right.
We've got a Holy Spirit that Jesus Christ said. He said, I go away to prepare a place for you.
Yeah, come on.
He said, my absence, I'm going to go away. He said, I'm going to send a comforter, Brother Paul. He said, this comforter is going to be the Holy Spirit, and it's going to reveal everything unto you. Listen, whenever I mess up, instantly, immediately, that Holy Spirit convicts my heart. I feel dirty, but I've got a choice right then whether I'm going to override it. I got a choice right then whether I'm going to call upon the name of the Lord. Hey, Deuteronomy, the Bible says in the 30th chapter and 19th verse, I set before you, Sister Deb, I set before you life or death, good or evil, and you've got a decision whether you want to choose to go or you want to choose to stay. You've got a decision whether you want to live after the Spirit or you want to walk after the flesh. You've got a decision whether you want to saved, or I'm going to serve God, or I'm going to do what makes this body happy. You've got the decision ultimately in the
end
to say, I am going to serve God.
That's right.
Amen.
I'm going to serve God. We're debtors. And listen, if we live after the flesh, then we will die. It's simple, Brother Bob. This is what he said. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. This is what it says, mortify, to do away with. Hey, to walk in the Spirit, the Apostle Paul wrote this. He said, to walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh.
That's right.
And you know what I heard Brother Minix up Carver one night say this, that you can't have two things on your mind at one time. And I tried it, you know what, after I heard that and after I listened to him say, I tried to think of two things at one time. I can't do it. Thus far, if I'm walking in the Spirit, then I'm not going to walk after the flesh.
Oh.
If I've got heaven on my mind, hey, if I've got the desires of the Spirit on my mind, hey, if I wake up every morning like the Apostle Paul said, and I crucify this flesh, and I transform my mind, and I'm not to the point in this world, then I will not walk in the flesh. Thus far, I will not die when I leave this world. For as many that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For they have received the spirit of bondage again.
Oh yeah, come on.
But they have received the spirit of adoption. Thereby we cry, Abba, the Father.
Come on.
He's saying, here is this. He's saying, whenever the Lord saved me, I have nothing else to worry about. Except for me trying to get to the kingdom of heaven. And you know what? As long as I walk in the Spirit, as long as I do as the Lord commands me to do, as long as I build that relationship with God, as long as I learn to discern that voice between good and evil, He'll always lead me in the right direction. He'll never leave me. He'll never fail me. Hey, He'll never leave me. Hey, the book of James says this. He says, every good gift and every perfect gift is given from above, from the Father of lights, where there is no valueless, neither shadow of turning, which means He do not differ, hey, one day from the next, which means He's the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. And I never have, brother, seen Him walking away from me. I've never seen Him cast a shadow and from His behind. Every time that I have been separated from the Lord, I have separated myself.
Amen.
Oh, I have separated myself every time.
Come on.
Bible said that every good gift and every perfect gift is given from God.
Yeah.
Every good thing is. There's no violence, neither shadow of turning. I don't have to worry about Him leaving me. Only if I separate myself from walking in the flesh, from doing the things that I know that the Holy Spirit tells me to start with, you shouldn't do that. And then I wind up doing it, and then the Holy Spirit convicts me after I do it. And He says, you shouldn't have done that. But you know what? I've got to learn from my mistakes. We're children.
Yes. Right.
We're children when we come into this thing. When we come unto salvation, we are children unto God. He says, listen, little children, abide in Him.
Abide in Him. Come on.
I have to stay in the center of God's will.
Come on, Joshua.
I have to do what God tells me to. That way He says this, little children, in 1 John. He says this, abide in me. That way in my coming you'll be able to look upon me in confidence.
Come on.
You ever, my little boy, he does something wrong and I holler at him. You know what? He's not, he's got his head down. He knows I messed up, Dad.
Come on.
I messed up. Every time that I holler at my boy, don't he, Jax? I holler at him. He knows he messed up. You know what he does? He drops his head. He don't even want to look me in the eye.
Come on, son.
You know what? When Jesus Christ comes back, Brother Bobby, this is the reason why the book of Luke tells us this. And all the parables in the four gospel tells us that we must be ready. We must have our loins girded about with truth. Hey, we must be ready to move. We must have our lights shining. Hey, we must be have our lights burning so that others can see and be ready to go in His coming. Hey, because when He comes back, I'm going to look at Him in confidence. I don't want to have to drop my head and know that I'm not going to make it, because at that point, there understand this and know that there is no hope for you. You may have come unto salvation at one point in your life.
Come on.
You know what? I'm not going to tell you. I'm not one of these preachers that, hey, unless people get mad if they want to. I'm not one of these because I don't know what my book says, Brother Paul.
Yeah, come on, John.
What's the best always in grace? Listen, you can stay saved as long as you stay with God.
Yeah.
But once you leave God, hey, that comes
you walk away.
Of him is broken. Hey, you have got, Brother Paul said, it's a marriage. And from the time that you accept the Lord in your life, you make a vow to God. Hey, whenever you sin and trespass against him, what you have done if you have committed adultery against God. You know what? That vow is broken. You've got to restore that with God. So I want you to understand something this morning, that if you're here and you're not in the place that you need to be, guess what? Your covenant, your vow that you have made with God is broken. And if God comes back right now, where do you think that you'll stand? Because there's no, I'm going to do better. There's no, Lord, give me one more chance.
Amen.
There's no, Lord, let me go back and fix it. It's done at that very moment. But this is what he said. He said, whenever I come in and I save you. He said, now listen. He said, I do not save you with a spirit of fear anymore. You don't have to fear these things, but you know what? He said, the look towards the mark of the high calling. He said, keep your eyes focused. He said, to guard your heart and let your eye be single. Keep your eye on the prize of your life. And after a while, all these heartaches and pains that we have to suffer here upon this earth, it's going to be worth it all, Sister Dean. Everything that I have done, everything that I have went through, is going to be worth every bit of it, Brother Paul. And the Bible said, blessed is the man that endures the temptation. For in his trials he'll receive a crown of life. Promised by God, he promised me. And I believe it with all my heart.
Amen.
As long as I serve him and I go through the things of this world, then it'll be worth it after a while. But he said this, he said, you're saved by the spirit of adoption. Now you know what? The Lord come walking down the street one day, Brother Paul, and I was in a cardboard box. Hey, he come walking down the street one day and he looked at me and he said, son, I tell you what, if you'll get up, I'm going to tell you this, if you'll get up and you'll follow me home, he said, I'll clean you up.
Yeah,
I'll feed you. He said, I'll give you everything that I've got.
Right. On,
he
God.
Called me one morning. He said, get up. Follow me home. Let me clean you. And let me give you a bath in the sun of my blood. Let me clean you from the inside.
Yeah.
He said, blessed is the man that hungers and thirsts after righteousness. For he shall be filled.
Yeah.
I want you to know this morning that I was adopted into a family. A family of Christ Jesus. I was adopted. Every man that took me in, that cleaned me up, that gave me his name, and that done all that I could ever ask for. I was adopted, Brother Paul. Every man that said, here's my credit card. Here's everything that I've got. It's yours. You can have it. Hey, but there's only one thing. If you're going to live under my roof, if you're going to do, if you're going to have everything, hey, that I give you, if all this is going to be given unto you, you're going to abide by my rules.
Amen.
If you're going to be my child, if I'm going to give you it all, if I'm going to do all these things, then you're still in debt to me. You're still in debt to me, which means you're going to abide. I don't want your money. What the Lord said, Brother J.R., he don't want that milk money you make.
No.
He don't want that money that you make.
No.
All that money you make from delivering milk, you know what? It's worthless to the Lord.
Yep.
You know what? Everything, whatever you live in is worthless. He don't want that. That's what he says. He says, you're a debtor to me. He don't want the things that you don't want. He don't want your cattle, Bobby. He don't want nothing that we've got. He don't want nothing that I've got. what he wants in my heart.
Yeah.
My whole heart. He said this, he said, you're in debt to me, I don't want nothing you got, but I want you to love me. And you will, listen, the Bible says this, Brother Paul. Hey, it says, oh, taste and see that I'm good. Blessed is the man that trusts in the Lord. Yes. You know what the Bible says in the book of Ephesians? It talks about a man drinking. Hey, he told him, he said, the man, hey, all these people get out and they're drinking, they're filled up with this whole liquor. And how do you get drunk? Anybody answer me, how do you get drunk? Don't sit in here and act like you ain't never drunk. How do you get drunk? You drink. I want you to understand something this morning. Hey, that if you want to get drunk on the Holy Spirit and you want Him to fill you, in order to be able to get drunk, you have to fill up. Hey, you've got to fill up with whatever you're drinking. In order for me, hey, to be able to fill up on the Holy Spirit, I have to drink of Him. I have to eat of Him. I have to think of Him. I have to put Him first in my life. He wants my heart, my whole heart, not just a piece of it, but He wants everything that I have.
Amen.
This is what He says. He says, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. He said this, I give you an offer. Made every possible preparation. I have given you everything, Brother Bobby, that you need. And all I ask in return that you abide by my rules. That you read this book. You listen to what it says. That you pray unto me. That you cry out to my name and you sit down and we have some serious talks. Listen, if you only pray once a week, there's something wrong with you and your salvation. If you don't talk to the Father every day, all day long, listen, I want you to understand something that's wrong. Because He's the most important thing in my life. I love my wife. I love my children.
Amen. Come on.
I love my family. But God's the most important thing in my life. And this is what we have to realize. We have to realize that if He's not, then we're going to tend to lean towards the things and the loves of this world. And what's going to happen is Satan is going to drag us further and further and further away. And then the book of Jeremiah and the book of Ezekiel, he talks about this. He said these people are going to be smitten back by perpetual backsliding. A never-ending backslide over and over again. Until you know what? It gets to a point where we don't even understand we're doing wrong. And we think that the lifestyle that we're living is right. We think that the things that we're living is right and the things that we're doing is right. You know what? It's just going to feel natural to us.
Yeah.
But listen, when the Holy Spirit begins to convict us, He said this. He said, I've adopted you. I filled you up. I give you drink. I cleanse you. I fed you. He said, I give you all that I want. Now you abide by my rules. You know what? I've got something, Brother Paul, that's going to be even better for you. I give you the Holy Spirit that dwells on the inside.
Amen.
You know what? I want you to understand that this morning, that if you're sitting here and the Holy Spirit convicts your heart, the Holy Spirit, listen, if you're here and you're saved, you've been adopted. You've been adopted by God. You are sons and daughters. Listen, you belong to God. You are a part of a family.
Come on.
Here's the thing. I want you to understand this. That if you have separated yourself from God by the sins and the things in this world. Listen, we talked this morning. It's not just the bad things that you've done. But the Bible says if you know you do good and you do it not, it's sin unto you. People put categories on sin. Sin is sin.
Amen.
And I told him, the Lord revealed this to me in a simple form one time. It is simple. It's simple. The Lord can do things and He can reveal things unto you and make you see things that it don't matter big words and big philosophers and these big teachers, just the simple things in this life. I was pulling out of the park one time, and ever since I've been able to drive, Brother Paul, the park right down here in the middle of town, the Raymond Memorial Park, since I've been able to drive, every time I come to that stop sign, there are another stop sign, every time I come to it, I just pull right on out and go. But you know what? There was an awful steep condemnation come down on my heart one time when I done that. Not because I run the stop sign, but because I was meditating on this already. You know what, brother? This is what the Lord revealed unto me. He said this. Whether you run that stop sign, or you run somebody off the road, or you go down into the middle of town and you do donuts up underneath the red light, violation of the law is violation of the law. You can get a ticket for either one.
That's right.
So I understood this in the simple form, that sin is sin.
Sin, sin.
Whether I do a big sin or I do a little sin, the Bible says this: if you keep a whole law, but yet offend in any one point, you're guilty of all. So it might not be the things that you're doing in your life, but what about the things you're not doing?
There you go.
What about the things whenever God puts it on your heart to say, do, or go, and you refuse to not do it? The Bible said, if you know to do good, you do it not, it's sin unto you. Sin is sin. So whenever you're adopted by God, you're His son and you're His daughter, He has given you everything. So whenever He speaks to you, you listen. If you've not listened, and you separate, you feel a separation from God, listen, before you leave here this morning, and the Holy Spirit convicts your heart, and you can feel it on the inside, and nobody has to tell you. Listen, I'm not surprised, because if I can feel the Holy Spirit here this morning, I'm not surprised if the Holy Spirit's not already convicted your heart.
Come on!
And the Bible said, we read about it in the 7th chapter of Romans this morning, where good is evil always present. I would say, Brother Paul, that Satan's right beside these people that the Spirit's already convicted.
Yeah.
He's sitting right beside you and he's whispering in your ear.
Oh, yes, he is.
Whatever you've got going on in your life, you can wait. He's whispering this in your life as Brother Paul gets ready to come. He's whispering this in your life right now. These things that this brother is preaching about living according to this world and doing the things of this world and being separated from God, they can wait. Or these people's going to look at you. They think that you've done something really bad. You know what? I'll hit this altar. I don't care what anybody thinks of me.
Come on, Johnson.
You know what? The sister was talking earlier over here. Said that people might look at her. You know, listen, the Bible said, for Christ's sake, I don't care what they say about me. If I want to get in the middle of town and hoop and holler and jump and scream and the Holy Spirit comes down upon me, let them talk.
Amen. Come on, God.
Let them say what they want to, because I know after a while, I don't care what the people think of me. I'm worried about what God thinks.
Amen.
I'm worried about that last thought that's going to be in God's mind that says either you're going to enter in or either you're going to depart from me. So I ask if everybody, as they get ready to sing this song, I ask if everybody bow your head this morning. I want all Christians praying, and I want you to be thinking honestly within your heart, within yourself, and what you think. Lord, am I in the place that I need to be with you? And you know what? Say you don't even have to ask me, because the Holy Spirit's done revealed it unto you.
And he wonders why
this is the thing. The next choice that you make in your life, that's one of the little choices that we were talking about earlier. That's going to alter God's big decision.
I tell him I'm serving Jesus.
So when the Holy Spirit's bidding you to step out, come down and fix what's broken in your life, and you're refusing. Remember me this morning. I need your prayers. Ain't nobody looking around. It's just in between you and God.
And I'm lost in the dark.
You're here this morning. I'm separated from God. I want you to understand this perfectly clear.
But then one night,
you spent 2.5 hours in a church service, and your heart's open condition, then you don't need up your praying, you know what? These people want to pray with you. If it takes until 5 o'clock today, you know what? If you want to come and pray, I'll stay right here with you.
Listen, this altar is open this morning.
Understand this. Understand this.
Yes, go left.
There's coming a time whenever you're going to want to pray and you can't.
Can you explain?
There's coming a time when you're going to stand before God and you're going to beg God, please give me a chance. The Bible said every knee's going to bow, every tongue is going to beg. That's the Lord of Lords and His King of Kings. And I believe as they drag you away, Jesus is praying for you. I believe, Brother J.R., whenever they drag you away and you
die,
this life. Over the Lord to give you one more chance.
Amen.
Why ask this morning if you're in that condition, step out
and call my name.
Make things right. Make that decision in your life.
He called my name. I heard His voice. He called my name. They'll stay at your house. Oh, I took Him in. He forgave all my sin. And He called me by name. He called my name. I heard His voice. He called my name.
You know what? This is what we do get. We get the joy of knowing that the Lord's been able to use us as vessels. And we get, we understand is that the Lord has given us love. And we love each and every one of you. So if the Lord deals with your heart sometime or another and the Lord blesses you to have another chance, I don't know, everybody here may be in the place that they need to be, Brother Paul. Right. But it's just on my heart to tell you this morning that it don't matter where you are, it don't matter what situation that you're in, it don't matter, Brother Gary, where, it don't matter if you're back, I know you like the rabbit hunt, if you're back on the hill, listen to the dogs run.
Come on.
The Lord speaks to your heart, kneel down right there where you are.
Amen.
And ask Him to come into your life, and He said this, I'm faithful, and I'm just to forgive.
Amen.
God bless you,
man.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'll tell you what, a good place to be this morning. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know what? It's all based on the truth.
He don't force you, he just asks. So, you know, I believe the word went out, truly do. And but now listen, I've got to say this. Who's on the cleaning list for this next week? You know, Susie is, who else, Susie?
Me, Brenda.
Loretta.
Loretta.
What are you guys going to wait till after Wednesday to do it, or are you going to do it before Wednesday? Because then we got Wednesday night service.
We're scheduled Tuesday.
When? Tuesday. Okay. Anybody else that can come out and help Tuesday, if you can, come out and help them. Because I like, you know, make sure the church is good clean, and then Wednesday night service, we'll clean up after the sale before we leave here and make sure that it's cleaned up. But come out and help them, because we need not only to make sure this church is clean and straight up over there, we need to make sure everything's ready to go for that. And so if you can come out too, you can help them. I'm sure they would be appreciative to it. Sister Susie, Loretta, and who else?
Juanie.
And I think Ashley's going to join you back here, Brenda. So, yeah, if we can have plenty come out and help them clean up, get ready for this fellowship. You know, it's not that I do care about what this place looks like. Why? Because God gave it to us.
Amen.
And I believe we need to maintain it and keep it in the way that it is. And we have a beautiful facility, and it's not that I'm showing off. It's just when you got company come to your house, you make your bed. You kind of sweep the floor up, or maybe shut the door. That's what I do, Cam. Shut the door, I'm going in. We're going to go in. If everything else is cleaned up, I want to be presentable. So we're hosting the fellowship. This is our turn. And we'll have plenty of food. If everybody brings plenty, the church provides the chicken and drinks and stuff, but we need dishes. Big dish, what? 6 o'clock it starts now, not at 7, 6. Pre-meeting, if you're an ordained deacon or minister, the pre-meeting starts at 5, and that's when just the ordained and the elders of the church get together. We talk about things that we can do to help the fellowship. We talk about things that we might be able to do to help in our community. To let the community see and know that these churches are bound together, not by a law, not by an organization, but because of fellowship we come together. That's what we decide to do. We're not bound by no oath. We don't have no code that we have to keep to be in that fellowship. It's just churches coming together, ignoring and dismissing the name above the door and putting Christ Jesus in there. And coming under that one common bond is that we all serve the same Lord. All right? All hearts and minds clear.
I had my name down between, I thought it was this week, but it was last week. And I was sick all week, so I apologize.
That's all right, man. Don't worry, it happened. It happened. Don't worry, baby.
Did we ever set a date for the mortgage burning ceremony?
Yeah, we did. It's June what? June the 9th. We are having, that's on a Saturday. We are having a little get together out back here. All the members are welcome. Everybody, friends, family.
No, it's out back or down
at the park?
No, it's the park. It's a big shelter on the park. That way you bring your kids.
Saturday after the fellowship.
But listen, we're doing hamburgers and hot dogs, but we need like pasta salads and chips and stuff like that if you want to bring. The church provides hamburgers and hot dogs.
What time
are we excited to have it?
10 o'clock, about 10.
About 10. We're going to start about 10. We're going to have cornhole. I'm sure we'll have bocce ball. We're not giving away any prizes, and we're going to do a mortgage burning. We're going to burn the mortgage of this place because it's painful.
Yeah.
It does. It's painful. That doesn't mean we stop working and stop trying because there's things that's going to come up that we're going to need in this church. We need blacktop. We need a lot of things.
We're getting